Hey everyone, I'm starting a new video series here that's slightly different from what I've done before. Previously I've been showing people like how to use easy-to-use software and talked a bit about tuning, but one thing I think a lot of people lack when they start tinkering with engines and start tuning engines and getting into mapping is understanding what's actually going on. You know, what are they actually trying to achieve? How are they going to achieve it? Because, you know, mapping is sometimes seen as this sort of mystical thing that's amazing and magical that makes power, but really mapping is the final stage of a long project. You know, you have to design your engine properly, your hardware properly, you have to make sure everything's going to flow properly. Because at the end of the day, everything comes down to basic physics. How much fuel can you burn? How efficiently can you burn it? And how efficiently can you convert that into useful motion down the road, you know, work pushing you down the road? So this series is going to go right back to basics. I'm not going to go deep into mathematics or trying to really sort of bore you with that, but just give you a fundamental understanding of what we're doing when we tune an engine. So in the first video we're going to talk about power and torque, because I've met people who've been tuning cars for years, who run businesses tuning cars, who still couldn't tell you the difference between what power and torque even is. So the first thing is, why do we even tune? Well, it breaks down to three things. You want to accelerate faster, you want to reach a higher top speed, or you want to get somewhere more efficiently. If you can drive 100 miles at half the price and fuel, why not? By tuning an engine, you're making it as optimized as possible, you will go faster, you will have a higher top speed, and you'll get a better mileage on your fuel. That's just the basics of being well tuned. Tuning isn't this mystical mystery thing that people think it is. It's just literally this: optimizing what you have, making what you have run correctly and well. There is no magic that one tuner can do over another to get more power than someone else's. It all comes down to the basic physics here. And if you find the optimal point, you'll make the most power, and by making the most power you'll have the fastest acceleration you can, the highest top speed you can, and the best efficiency you can. So first of all, you need to understand the basics of what the difference is between work and power. Work is a force and a distance or displacement. If you had a box that was 100 kilograms and you picked it up and you moved it 100 meters, you've done 100 kilograms over 100 meters. Equally, you could have a box that's only half the weight, say 50 kilograms, but if you take it over 200 meters, that would be the same amount of work. It would take the same amount of energy to move the same amount of mass, the same amount of distance, or a different amount of mass or weight over a longer or shorter distance, as long as they multiply to the same number, it's the same amount of energy. But work doesn't tell you how quickly you did something, you see. Now, I might on my own pick this box up, it's really heavy, and I move it 10 meters, I have a break, I move another 10 meters, I have a break, I move another 10 meters, I have a break. This 100 kilogram box is really, really difficult to move on my own. What if I had four people? We pick the box up between four of us, we're only lifting 25 kilograms each, then we took it the 100 meters, we put it down, we did it much quicker, but we only used the same amount of energy because we all did a quarter of the work each. But we did it much quicker. Because we did it much quicker, we had more power output. In this case, four times the power output. Because let's say it took me an hour to move that box on my own. When you've got four people, we could have done it in 15 minutes, which means you could have done it four times over. So this is the difference between work and power. Work is how much work you do, but has no concept of how quickly you did it. Power is how much you did and how quickly you did it. So how do engines do work? Well, what we do is we take fuel and we burn it. Now, for every kilogram of petrol in your tank, there is a certain amount of energy in there. Now, this number is different for petrol, for ethanol, for diesel, but for petrol, it's 46.4 megajoules of energy in a kilogram of fuel. And what we do, we take this fuel, we inject it into our engine, and we burn it. That's combustion. When we do this, we convert the chemical energy stored in the fuel into heat energy. And then what we're trying to do is then get as much of this heat energy to push our piston down, rotate our crankshaft, and make our wheels turn and go faster. But internal combustion engines are really inefficient. Like, we only get 20 to 35% of the energy actually converted to pushing our piston down, rotating our crank, and making our wheels turn. 65 to 80% of that energy in heat is lost. Down the exhaust, into the metal of the engine, into the cooling system, all sorts of energy is lost. There's also things like frictions and resistance and pumping losses. Loads of energy is wasted and not turning our wheels or turning our crankshaft to make the fly will move. You're measuring at the fly, or you're measuring at the wheels, you know, at which point you measure it at, there's more things that are consuming and wasting energy. But what's actually happening here is when you push the piston down, you're pushing a lever onto a crankshaft, and that crankshaft is rotating. And when you rotate something, you're applying a torque to it. So this is what torque actually is. So as I said earlier about moving the box with four people being quicker than moving it with one person, if torque is how much an engine can do, you know, in terms of work, it can rotate once and it can do a certain amount of torque, the faster you move an engine, the quicker it can make torque, or more often it can make torque. Therefore, it does more power, it's doing more work in the same time period. So we take the work component of our equation as being the torque the engine produces, and we calculate power based on how quickly it does it, i.e. how many rotations it can do in a time period. So RPM, you all know about your rev counters, 2000 RPM. If you're making the same torque at 2000 RPM as you're making at 4000 RPM, you're there by definition making twice as much power at 4000 because you're doing the same amount of torque twice as often in the same minute. So an engine makes torque. Well, torque is measured as a force multiplied by a distance. And a metric torque, we use newtons and meters. And so 100 newton meters can be made up of several different combinations of the distance from the point of rotation or the force you're pushing on that lever. Just as like when you use a ratchet that's short to undo a bolt, it could be very difficult. You get a 2 foot bar, you do the same thing, suddenly it's much easier to undo that bolt, for example. You know, you're applying the same force, but you're doing it over a longer lever, you're creating more torque because you're doing it over a longer distance. So 100 newton meters could be anything from, say, 1 newton over 100 meters. It could also be 100 newtons only 1 meter. All of them equate to the same torque. If you're talking imperial units, you use pounds force and feet, which is quite common in America or the UK, we'll talk in pounds foot. And there is a difference in size, just like you'd use centimetres and inches to measure things, and they're both perfectly valid to use, they are different. So you can see 100 newton metres is only 73.8 pounds foot. So how much power is made? Well, power is work divided by time. We can now work out how much torque we're creating with the engine, and we know we're doing certain revolutions per minute. And we can use this lovely equation, which is power is equal to torque times 2 pi times revolutions per minute. Or, if we know we're using foot-pounds, we can simplify this, because 1 horsepower is 33,000 pounds foot a minute. Simplifies to the good old, well-known, horsepower is equal to torque times RPM divided by 5252. Now this is where the old myth that dyno graphs cross at 5252 comes from, because if you take 100 foot-pounds, for example, or pounds foot should I say, times it by 5252, then divide it by 5252, you get 100 again. But this is also where it's not true, because if you scale your graphs on different size axes, one's on 1000 to 0 to 1000, one's on 0 to 500, the lines won't cross there anymore, they'll cross somewhere else on the graph screen, but the value will always be the same at 5252. Unless, of course, you're not measuring in horsepower and pounds foot. For example, if you're measuring in kilowatts or newton meters, then the equation changes. It simplifies down to newton meters times RPM divided by 9549, which means unless you're revving to over 9,500, the lines will never cross. So that's an internet myth that's around there. There is some truth behind it, but it doesn't have to be true. So how do we make more torque then? Well, we either make more torque by burning more fuel, because there's a certain amount of energy in that fuel which converts to work or torque, or we take more of the heat from that burn and convert more of it to useful work rather than wasting it. And how do we make more power? Well, you make more torque, or you rotate the engine faster, increasing the frequency of the work. As I said, if you make the same torque at 2000 RPM and the same torque at 4000 RPM, you'll make more power, double the power in fact. If you can make the same torque at 6000, you'll there be at triple the power. So increasing a rev limiter, for example, and making an engine rev higher, will make, by as a byproduct, more power, assuming you can keep making the same amount of torque. One way, the easy way of making more torque is to burn more fuel. Well, it's easy. We can get bigger injectors, we can squirt more fuel in an engine, yeah, and we're making more torque, yeah? No, not that simple, because to burn fuel, you require oxygen. The hard part is getting oxygen into your engine to burn the fuel. We get the oxygen from the air. This is why you have an air filter. You suck air into your engine. You compress it, you burn the fuel, you put it out the exhaust. You're pumping air. So supplying fuel is easy, supplying more air is harder. You can either do several things to get more air. You can make the engine contain more air by being larger, so more cylinders or larger cylinders. You can make the air cooler, therefore more dense. You can make the air pressure higher, such as turbocharging or supercharging it to make it more dense. Or you can increase what's known as the engine's volumetric efficiency. Now, this is how much air you're actually getting in a cylinder. You might have a cylinder that's half a litre, for example, but it doesn't mean you're getting a full cylinder. If the engine's moving so fast and the valves are moving really fast, you might only be getting, you know, 80%, 85% of that sort of cylinder full. You might not be filling that cylinder to 100%. So those are the four ways of getting more oxygen or more air into an engine. So we can brute force it by burning more fuel, but it gets to a point, as you see, where we can't burn more fuel because we haven't got enough air supply. So what about making the engine more efficient, extracting more useful work from the heat energy? Well, there's several ways to do this. We increase the compression. We could optimize the ignition timing of the combustion. That means we fire the spark plug at the perfect time to extract as much of that heat energy into pushing the piston down rather than being wasted. We could optimize the mixture of the air-fuel ratio, and that means that we get the hottest burn possible, therefore more expansion. If we run overly rich, we're actually losing heat, because the burn is cooler, therefore you're not as efficient. We could reduce the pumping losses or friction losses inside the engine, you know, piston rings rubbing against the cylinder walls. You know, there's many things that are taking away useful work of turning the wheels, because energy has to be used to resist these frictions. Another option is we could recover wasted heat energy. Now, this is something such as turbocharging. You are using wasted heat energy that's gone down the exhaust, no longer useful to the engine, and using it to turn a turbine, and that turbine is being used to drive a compressor. That is using excess heat that would have otherwise been wasted. This is why turbocharging is actually more efficient than, say, supercharging. Another way you could do it, for example, is some sort of hybrid energy recovery system. If you combine turbocharging and hybrid energy recovery, you could actually create a very efficient engine. But even then, the most efficient engine I've known of is the Mercedes F1 engine, which managed to crack an amazing 50%. They're still wasting half the energy. So it's worth understanding that the amount of power you make in an engine is directly related to the amount of air or fuel you consume in a certain time period. We all talk about fuel pumps flowing X number of litres per minute or per hour. Injectors are rated in cc's a minute or pounds per hour. All of this comes down to how much fuel you can supply an engine within a time period. Well, because power relates to how much work you do in a time period, you're going to use a certain amount of fuel in a time period. Now, the amount of air and fuel you use in a single combustion relates to the amount of torque you produce. Now, you can have two very different engines that produce the same power, which will require very similar air-fuel flow rates because they're producing the same amount of power, but they could do it in very different ways. For example, you could have a large truck engine that produces huge amounts of torque, very large combustions at a very low RPM, maybe as low as 2000 RPM, but it can still make 800 horsepower, for example. Think back to the old V8, you know, F1 engines that produced 700, 800, 900 horsepower. Well, they did it with very little torque, but they revved to 20,000 RPM, so they used lots of small combustions very, very often and very, very fast intervals. But the total amount of power would be the same in both these engine cases. But the way they divide that amount of fuel or air in a minute into a number of either small combustions or very few big combustions will still relate to the same amount of overall flow rate. And so this is why you can look at an engine as an air pump. How much it pumps in one cycle will relate directly into its torque output. How much it can pump over a time period, well, that will relate directly to its power output. So to go along with what I've been saying in the previous slides, rather than just talking, let's look at an actual visualization of what we're talking about. So what I've got here is a spreadsheet that basically gives you standard air mass so the mass of air in grams per litre at sea level. The engine size, the size per cylinder, the number of cylinders. Then we've got the manifold temperature and pressure we can change as well. And this calculates out what a standard cylinder will hold. So a standard cylinder will hold, for this engine, 0.6 grams of air for every litre. What we've got here is the fuel density of petrol and the energy density of petrol, i.e. how many joules of energy are in each gram of petrol. The stoichiometric air-fuel ratio we'll be burning the fuel at. Now, I've included lambda in here just so we can get an idea of injector sizing and fuel pump sizing as well. So this being a naturally aspirated engine, we're going to go for a lambda of 0.9. So I've put in here as well an injector size typical for that sort of engines. We can also calculate injector duty cycle. So at different engine RPMs, we've got the volumetric efficiency of the engine. That will give us how many grams each cylinder fill. And that will run, calculate out to what a flow rate of air through the engine is going to be. Down here I've got fuel flow, so how many grams of fuel will we burn with the air going into the cylinder. And then we've got the injector flow rate in CC, which you're normally accustomed to seeing when you buy an injector. And then also the injector duty cycle to say, you know, our injectors are good size for what we're doing. And finally, you'll need to know what the fuel pump's going to do. So can your fuel pump handle it? Well, if you've got a 200 litre per hour fuel pump, you're more than good enough on this engine. And now we're down to thermal efficiency. So I've assumed that it being a typical road-going naturally aspirated engine, we're going to have 20% thermal efficiency throughout. So this is what you'd class as a perfect 2-litre engine that revs to 8,000. It'll make 230 horsepower for a road-going petrol sort of standard road-going octane fuel. So this is a perfect power curve. It goes up all the way. Torque is constant across the entire rev range. Now, a real engine is not like this. A real engine will actually breathe less well at the bottom end. So let's reduce the volumetric efficiency, so less air is getting in the cylinder at different points. We'll say that the peak efficiency can be around 5,000-6,000, and then we'll start to reduce the volumetric efficiency of the engine, and you can start to see a more curvy sort of dyno graph of what you're normally used to seeing. You can also see that our power output has dropped down to 207 horsepower. Now, interestingly, if you look here, the airflow of the engine starts to show a curve very similar to the power curve. Now, generally speaking, at high RPM, you're going to have less thermal efficiency, more friction, so let's start reducing our thermal efficiency as we rev round. And now you can see, we start to see a more arcing over power curve, and suddenly our engine is only producing 166 horsepower. So the perfect engine that could make 230, suddenly now is only making 166 horsepower. So depending how efficient your engine is, let's just say we can get 1% more efficiency across the board because we can raise the engine's compression. So let's do 21, 21, 21, 21, 20, 19, 18, 17. Just getting that extra compression on the engine has boosted us by 10 horsepower. Let's say we put a set of racy cams in the engine, so now it actually gets 95% efficiency here, 100% efficiency here, but we start to lose some low end because we're not breathing as well because our cams aren't optimised for this. And this is what you'll get on an NA sort of car that you tune for track. You'll start to lose all your bottom end response, and you might get a more peaky graph like this. So now you're now making 186 horsepower. You've got nice flat torque at mid-range to high RPM, but your bottom end's suffering. So you can see here how the energy density of the fuel and the efficiency of the engine breathing, and then the thermal efficiency of the engine, which is down to compression ratio, ignition mapping, and so on, directly affects the shape of the power and torque curves. You can see the torque curve here as the cylinder fill. So you can see here, this is cylinder fill. As the cylinder fill starts to increase, we increase torque, and it starts to decrease, we'll start to decrease in torque. Equally, as if we start to lose off thermal efficiency, torque will go down. Now, as we rev higher, where the torque stays the same, the power will continue to climb. But when power starts to flatten off, torque has to decline. It just has to, they're mathematically related. So I've reset the graph up to a sort of typical naturally aspirated factory 2-litre engine that makes around 160 horsepower. I've assumed it's got a fairly standard road going cam, so the breathing falls off over 7,000 RPM. And I've also assumed that the ignition timing has been left a little bit soft, just to sort of put it on sort of standard octane, you know, normal pump fuel, not high octane fuel, just a normal standard unleaded fuel. So if we were tuning this engine, let's say the maximum thermal efficiency of this engine before it gets to detonation on high octane fuel is 21%. So without changing compression ratio or changing any mechanical hardware on the car, the maximum we can ever achieve is to add approximately 2% thermal efficiency across the board by, say, advancing the ignition time mapping. So let's say we've managed to put an extra 2% across the board, just an example. So this becomes 20%, 20%, 20%, 21 rather, 21, 21, 20, 19, 17. So by adding ignition timing to the map, getting to the point that we can get to before we hit detonation on the fuel we've got, the maximum increase you could ever get on this engine is to 180 horsepower. That's it. There is no magic that one tuner can suddenly get 200 horsepower out of the engine just by mapping it. Unless you can somehow increase the thermal efficiency of the engine, i.e. advance timing, or raise the compression, that engine's not going to make any more power. That is it. That is all you can have. Now, if you want to make more power, you need to increase the breathing. Let's say the exhaust's fairly restrictive on here, and let's say by changing the exhaust we pick up a couple of percent more volumetric efficiency. So let's raise it by 72, 87, 92, 92, 94. Let's say it starts to restrict top end, because a small bore exhaust, so you're going to get 1% here, 1% here, but the top end, you know, it's already quite restricted, so we might pick up a couple of percent there. You can see here we picked up very little peak power. We've got some more torque through the band. So what can we do next to the engine? Well, let's say we swap out for a set of high lift cams. Now, it is possible with some very clever manifold designs and cam timings to actually get like a ram effect and actually get just over 100% efficiency. Let's say we've spec'd this engine to as best we can in terms of cams and profiles, but these cams are really rubbish down the bottom. So let's say we've got 65% VE here, we've only managed 70% here, 75. It's got 80% VE here. Now we're starting to pick up 90, but top end, this is where those cams come into their own. We've got 100% VE here, we've got 105% here, and we can actually rev higher. Rather than arcing over after 7,000, let's say we're now up to 95% efficiency at 8,000. Or maybe even let's go better than that, let's go 102. Now you can see how the bottom end of the graph has been affected by the lack of airflow, and how the airflow has reduced at the bottom of the engine. But we're making a lot more power top, and we're making nearly 200 horsepower. And this is the reason a 200 horsepower NA car might not drive as well as the standard 170 horsepower car, because you've lost the bottom end by putting a racy cam in there. Now let's say we change the pistons out, we've gone really high on compression, we're going to go from proper race pistons and we're going to run some race fuel. We can get some more, you know, compression and more ignition in here. So let's say we're going to have a 2% up on thermal efficiency across the board by more compression and more ignition timing because of the fuel quality. Let's say we can get to there, can't really get any more time in top end, say, oh, actually no, let's just say we get 1% more. It's possible to get, you know, 211 horsepower. When someone turns around and says, well, we can bolt some mods onto your 2-litre car, we can get you 240 horsepower without revving any higher, you know something's amiss here, they're talking rubbish. Because really, getting even like 23% on an NA car, you're doing very well in terms of thermal efficiency. Getting this 105% VE, you're doing really, really well. And so by looking at the data from an engine, looking at the airflow, you can backwards calculate from airflow what the approximate maximum power would be. You can also look at your ignition timing versus what the optimum ignition timing should be for a certain RPM or load, and say, well, am I close to my optimum ignition timing? Once you get close to optimum ignition timing, once you've got 100% airflow, or just over, that's it for NA engines. The only way for more power now is to increase the number of cylinders or increase the size of the engine. So let's say you bore it out to 2.2. It's now a 2.2-litre engine. Suddenly we've picked up another 20 horsepower, or 15 horsepower or so. Let's say we actually turbocharge it. So the manifold pressure raises from sea level to, let's say, half a bar. But we increase some temperature with the turbo. So it's now 40 degrees intake temps. Now you can see we're making around 300 horsepower, some racy cams. So this is how you can see what a real engine can do, just by going through the basic maths. To make power, you need to flow air. Our changes in pressure means we now flow more air. That is the nature of engine tuning. So what we're trying to do is get the optimum amount of airflow through an engine. You need to remember this, that an engine is an air pump. And pumping air through an engine, burning it as efficiently as possible, is what makes power and torque. I hope you found this interesting, and I'll make another video soon.